When it's Christmas music, it's 10 times better. But it is, as I've mentioned and Ashley mentioned, today is the not just the first Sunday of December, not just the first official day that even the most grumpy Christmas music hater of all, you know, that argument is over. Now you can sing Christmas music and play it, and no one will say, oh, it's not time for that yet. I mean, it's time for that now, okay? No matter what. But officially, according to the church calendar, according to what's called liturgy, today is the first Sunday of the season of Advent. And the first Sunday of Advent, by tradition, is known as the Sunday of Hope, also known as the Sunday of Prophecy or the Candle of Prophecy. And that's why there's only one of the total of five candles lit. You light a new candle each Sunday as you move through that season. And so that's why this is here. If you've never seen an Advent wreath before, if you've never seen some of those things, then don't feel left out or in the dark. In fact, though you can find references in early Protestant literature all the way back to the 16th century that mention having something like this in a church service, they didn't start doing it until the 18th century. So it took them 300 years to even kind of recognize how people might do it. And you can do it all sorts of ways. Many of you have heard this and know this. You traditionally will have three candles of one color and then a separate candle that is a different color. Now, why purple and I would call that pink, but it's technically called rose. Why those colors? Because these are, we don't do this, but these are the liturgical colors for the Sundays of Advent. So if we were a more liturgical worship style church, I would wear a robe, and what I wore around my neck would change color on a fairly regular basis. There is a liturgical calendar. And so for the first two Sundays of Advent, it's purple, and then the third Sunday is rose, and then the fourth Sunday is purple again, and then ending with a service on Christmas Eve where you light that white candle in the middle, which is the Christ candle. So the one that stands out the most that gets only lit on the third Sunday. That's the one that's named. No, I don't know if I'm named after it or it's named after me. But anyway, that's the joy candle. Now, that's how the Advent wreath works. Now, what it signifies, we'll talk about here in just a minute. But I know what's really on some of your minds, whether you've seen it 100 times or this is your first time, you're wondering, why is that dude wearing such amazing threads? And the truth is, because life is too short and boring to not recognize when a special time is upon us. So I have way uglier stuff than this. I have a suit that lights up. Many of you know it. I have another suit that looks like lights, but it doesn't light up, and it also doesn't fit a man as fat as me, so you won't see that one. But I have plenty of goofy sweaters because it does occasionally make people smile or make people wonder, what is he wearing? And even then, sometimes it will start a conversation. Like, you know, the tie doesn't even go all the way down to your, it's supposed to touch your belt, you know, and I'm, hey, makes it look better. Anyway, but, you know, you can't even buy this anymore. I don't know. I told my wife, I know the joke is it must have shrunk in the wash, but she must be shrinking my stuff, you know. But anyway, I like Christmas. I hope you know exactly why I wear the shoes that I wear. But if you need a refresher, my favorite televised Christmas event, there's the Grinch who. How many of you are old enough to remember that you couldn't stream this stuff? You had to wait for it to come on TV, and your mom had to tell you, hey, tonight at 6 p.m. on Channel 5, the Grinch who stole Christmas. And that was like a humongous deal. Now you got old enough to like buy it on DVD or stream it, and you realize that cartoon's about 12 minutes long. And they played it over a 30-minute. It was just a reason to show kids advertisements. It kills me. Grinch Who Stole Christmas. What else do you remember? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, that one? And it made the most awful sound when his nose would turn on. It would go, and even as a kid, I'm like, oh, I don't really like that noise. Kris Kringle, not so popular, but the same sort of kind of style as that. But the best one of all, originally made to be a simple advertisement for Coca-Cola, is the Charlie Brown Christmas, where Charlie Brown is taught the true meaning of Christmas. Now, I love the Grinch. I love Rudolph. I love that stuff. I love all of the traditions of this season, most of the traditions of this season. But what I love most of all is the truth. And never before, and really and truly aimed at children never since, was something like that Charlie Brown Christmas special created. They wanted to cut it completely, but they refused to take that one moment where Linus tells Charlie, I'll tell you the true meaning of Christmas. So my tennis shoes are, whatever kind of shoes they are. There's Charlie Brown with his little pitiful tree, and there's Snoopy with his beautifully decorated house. But the reason you'll have to see these every single Sunday of Advent is because what I'm wearing on my feet was the very first Christmas present I was ever given as a father. So my oldest son bought these right about the time he was 14 years old, and this January he's going to be 23. So we're working our way towards being a decade old, but this was the very first thing I was ever given by a child for Christmas. That honor would always have belonged to him because he's the oldest. And so he bought Dad these Christmas shoes. And so how many of you know this already? They sleep in their own box, the original box they came in with the original little wax paper. After Christmas is over, I will quietly wrap them back up just like they were new and seal them off and let them sleep for 11 more months. And then poof, they come out. And the only time they've come out not on Advent season was when I performed his wedding. And so as formal as a wedding is supposed to be, the pastor of that wedding was wearing these shoes the whole time. And those are some of my thoughts when we get to this time of year. And you know what I know also about this time of year? It both seems to take forever and get here all at once. We go from it not being anywhere near Christmas. We go from even back to school sales and kids moaning because they have to go back to homework and writing papers. And all of a sudden, somebody's telling you you have to put up a Christmas tree. They're singing Christmas songs at church. And before I know it, I have to use a new calendar. Why does it take me so long to get to the end and then the end go by so quickly? Sometimes it's because we have loaded every moment of that season with different gatherings, different opportunities to be with people, to love people, and sometimes, if we tell ourselves the truth, we do that so much that we begin to bemoan and begrudge the events themselves. Like, oh, I have another Christmas party. Oh, I have another dinner. If that happens to us, I think it's important for us to then realize we should pause and begin to wonder to ourselves, what should we remove? Because when the event steals from us the joy of the season, then the event is doing the exact opposite that I would believe that event is intended for. Like, for example, lighting a candle about something like hope. Because sometimes in your regular life, in a difficult time of life, in a challenging time on earth, there are all sorts of situations and reasons that we might get to a point and ask ourselves, hope in what? Like, what should I be hoping in? What's the point of hoping? They're about to launch missiles on the other side of the earth that will make us launch missiles, and then you won't be able to go outside anymore because of radiation and nuclear damage. And they're about to make food cost so much that half the people will starve. And they're about to make houses cost so much that people can never live in anything but a tent for the next 30 years. All you have to do is spend a little time with a person who's just a little dejected, and they will make it sound as though there is nothing positive at all, and there is no reason for us to have any hope whatsoever. And sometimes we will fall victim to that without any help from an outside source because of the things that have happened in our own lives. Difficulties at work or obtaining work, difficulties inside our homes, in our families, with our loved ones, and even those that we struggle to love. Sometimes we don't even stop to realize that while I would tell you that there is such a vast amount of joy to be gleaned from this season, there are those who hate to see this season come because of memories or absences or things unresolved that took place or that kind of camped themselves around this time of year. So then how dare I or how dare anyone light a candle and think about the hope of the world, or the hope of this season. And so I, without any denial, recognize that it is very simple to be stuck asking ourselves, hope in what? So this morning, let's answer that question. because God has always given us something to hope for, not just in the promise that he made, but the promise that he kept and the promise that is yet to be. And so first, in answering the question of hope in what, let's recognize that we're hoping in the promise that was made. Number one is hoping in the promise that was made. Now we see that biblically, and I've made a couple of references for you there. Jeremiah 31, 31, perhaps one of the most famous passages in Jeremiah, where God, speaking through the prophet, says this, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah." And what's important there is that the Bible says, I will make a new covenant. There was an old covenant, or what we would call the first covenant, and that covenant was the covenant of the law. That covenant was the covenant of sacrifice and blood. That was the covenant of perfection. And that was the covenant, by the way, unless, and I mean no disrespect when I say this, any of you are Jewish. But unless I'm wrong, I think I'm right, none of you are, including me. Well, then that old covenant was one in which you could not partake. If the old covenant still stood and was never changed, then you and I, outside of the family of God, being Gentiles, would literally have no hope. But here the prophet was able to speak the words of God and say, the days are coming when I will make a new covenant. Now you may even recognize that when it's repeated by me quite regularly when we take communion. And I will say, this was a covenant that he was making with all people. Because the new covenant didn't just include Israel and Judah. And how do we know that? In many ways, but one of them is something that Paul says in 2 Corinthians 3. Here he says in verse 5, we are not adequate in ourselves so as to consider anything as having come from ourselves. But our adequacy is from God, who also made us adequate as servants of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. So this new covenant was not the law. It wasn't the letter of the law that people were keeping. It was the Spirit that God dwelt within them. And that was available to all who would receive it. In fact, I might not think enough is made of this, or I don't even know what I mean by that, except to say that so much of the New Testament is trying to explain that the covenant included the Gentiles. Paul, the most prolific author of the New Testament and the most prolific missionary in the New Testament period, he is known as the missionary to the Gentiles. He spoke to those who had been outside the covenant for forever and telling them, no, now it's been changed. Now something has been accomplished that you might also have hope. Peter, the missionary to the Jews, struggled to understand this. And they came to odds with one another over it. And Peter would eventually understand by the leadership of Jesus that it's for everyone, Peter, not just the chosen few. Anyone who wants hope can have it. But this didn't start with Jeremiah. This didn't start with Moses. This started in the Garden of Eden. And why it matters that we know this is because you need to know that you were never God's alternative decision. Regardless of what's happened to you, regardless of what you might consider yourself guilty of, you were never God's, well, I guess. You were always God's point. The restoration of his kingdom and the restoration of a relationship between you and your Creator was always the point of the covenant. And you see that in Genesis 3:15. Now, if you like knowing stuff that most people would be like, huh, and it doesn't get you a discount at McDonald's, I already tried. But Genesis 3:15 is called the Proto-Evangelion. Now, some people will say the Proto-Evangelion, and you tell them they were taught how to speak incorrectly. The Proto-Evangelion, the prototype good news, is Genesis 3:15. Genesis 3 is the fall of mankind. This is where Adam and Eve commit the grievous sin of disobeying God. The riches that he had blessed them were not enough, and so they had to have a little something more. Satan comes in the form of a serpent and says, did God really say that you couldn't eat from the tree? And she said, well, he said we can't eat from that tree and we can't touch the fruit that's on it. If we do that, we'll die. And Satan questions her and says, nah, that's not really what he meant. In fact, she had misquoted him anyway. He doesn't want you to eat that because if you eat it, you'll turn into him. You'll become like him. You'll know things. You'll be wise like him. And so she desired that. That's why some will argue theologically that the first sin to ever be committed on earth is the sin of pride. Now, surely none of us are guilty of having pride anywhere in our lives. And that's sarcasm. Of course we do. We think we deserve the things that we have, and worse still, we think we deserve the things we don't. I should drive a Cadillac. I should own a bigger house. It's unfair that people do. That's pride. That's why Eve and Adam both ate of the fruit of the garden from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And so Adam is told, since you did that, here's the punishment. And Eve is told, since you did that, here's the punishment. And Genesis 3:15 is the devil being given his punishment. And so the proto-euangelion, the prototype, the first run of the good news that we ultimately would come to understand in the person of Jesus Christ was spoken over the serpent when God said this, I will make enemies of you, the devil, and the woman, and of your offspring and her descendant. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. Other translations say he will crush your head, but you will bruise him on the heel. This is a description of the Messiah. Nowhere there is the name Jesus, but the reference to the Messiah is there. Thus it is the prototype, the proto-good news. From the very beginning, from the Garden of Eden, before Adam and Eve are even ejected from God's presence, God is telling the devil, I'll get them back. I will make everything you just broke whole. Just wait. So when you consider Advent and candles and celebrations, and the point that the first Sunday of worship has always, since the inception of this tradition, been dedicated to reminding ourselves of hope, then part of why we are unlike anyone else on earth, why I can hope in spite of everything else, is because of a promise that was made in the Garden of Eden, echoed out in the prophet's writing in Jeremiah 31. A new covenant is coming. And then recognized in the writing of Paul when he says, I'm a minister of, or a presenter of, this new covenant. But another reason that I can have hope is because I have hope in the promise kept. He didn't just make the promise, you see, he kept his promise. God didn't say, I'll restore you, but you got to go figure it out. He said, I'll restore you, and then he restored. Now, did it take a little time? Well, by our count, yes, but by the one who lives outside of time, I assume it took no time at all. That will rattle around in your head maybe once you leave church and be like, ooh, deep. Anyway, in Luke 1 and 2, you find the Christmas narrative. Now, you will find a portion of it in Matthew as well, but famously, most people return to Luke chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2 to find what we call the Christmas story. It begins with a man named Zechariah in the temple. And one of the most beautiful things ever to be told, Gabriel says to Zechariah, your prayers have been heard. Have you ever stopped for a moment? Let me just ask you a question. Have you gone to church long enough that you forgot that when you worship, it's to glorify the actual creator of the universe? Like, it isn't attending a concert. It isn't going to a lecture. It isn't going to meet someone famous or get an autograph. You gather in a church, in what's called a sanctuary, literally a set-apart place, a place of holiness, to worship not a man, but the whole Creator. You ever stop and question how your attitude is as you do that? I do, all the time. Am I too busy thinking about what comes next in the worship service, or when can I sit down, or I don't really like this music, or man, it's kind of hot in here, all those different things? Or do I stop and think, in spite of everything I've done between the last time I was here and now, He still let me walk in here, and He still let me call His name. And then, as Gabriel said to Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Or in other words, for us, God is saying, I'm listening. The creator of the universe. Can you get an audience with the president of the United States? Now, I don't know how big of a deal some of y'all might be. I'm already saying you're not Jewish because I think I know that. But I don't know, y'all might secretly be a way bigger deal than I understand. And I think you're a pretty big deal, but I think you're a pretty big deal because God says so. But according to the world and civilization, are you that big of a deal that you can pick up the phone right now and have an audience with the President of the United States? No. Can you get an audience with the President of Canada? Can you have an audience, you? Now, I also happen to know, since you're sitting in here, you're probably not Catholic, but could you get an audience with the Pope? And yet, by opening your mouth, you can have an audience with the Creator of the universe. Those of you who have gathered on Sunday mornings and studied in small group through the book of Revelation, weeks ago, you studied the beginning of that book, where the throne room of heaven is described, where God sits on His throne, unseen because the light is so bright, surrounded by a rainbow, a sea of glass lay out before Him, and more than can be counted, angels and beings at the foot of His throne, worshiping. And at the whole of this noise and this cacophony, there is claps of thunder and lightning and these really weird beings circling the top of the throne, covered in eyes and wings, and their one job is to nonstop proclaim, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. All of that is taking place, never ending, without fail. And when I say, hey, Dad, through all of that, He's listening to you and to me. The most beautiful thing you might ever stop to hear is what Gabriel said to Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Zechariah has some trouble with that because the prayer was for the Messiah. For 400 years, no prophet had spoken by the time Zechariah is in the temple. And so they've been praying, hey, haven't really heard from you in a little minute. We're really desperate for the Messiah down here. You promised, see, you made a promise that you would restore things, that you would institute this new covenant, that something new would come. We would be your people. You would be our God. There would be no trouble. A branch from the tree of Jesse would stay on the throne and never leave it. We could use that. And Gabriel says, God's listening. And so you're going to have a son, and he's going to be the herald of that Messiah. In other words, now it's happening. For all the years of life, it hasn't, but now it's happening. What does Zechariah say? That's impossible. I'm too old for this. And so he's struck mute. He cannot speak. In the show I took these folks to in Missouri, he couldn't hear either. And I'm like, huh? But whatever, that's fine. The Bible says he can't speak. 6 months later, that same angel Gabriel visits a young lady named Mary. That young lady is younger than you're probably used to thinking. She's probably 13, 14 years old. And Gabriel says something to her that, again, I don't think we have spent enough time as individuals thinking through. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. And then he tells her, you are highly favored. Now forgive me, inside of my sin of pride, if you tell me I'm favored, I start thinking how things are supposed to be in my life. Like if I'm favored, I'm not supposed to know difficulty. I'm not supposed to know poverty. Favored means rich. It means healthy, wealthy, and wise. It's exactly what the Pharisees thought. But if you know anything about Mary and the life that she will be asked to live from this moment on, her life is nothing about wealth, nothing about popularity. And yet Gabriel says, you are highly favored among all other women. You know why? Because you are going to bear the Messiah. That thing that's been waited for so long, now he comes and you will give birth to him. This was the promise being kept. And it's recorded for us in Luke chapter 1 and 2 specifically. And in verses 6 and 7, no cacophony, no trumpets, no parade. It literally just says, and when they got to Bethlehem, the time was accomplished that she should give birth. And so she did. Gave birth to a son in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. That's it. So you mean to tell me that God kept his promise by having that kid born in a place dirtier than I was? In fact, when I was born, I don't know, I wasn't really paying a lot of attention, but, you know, 46 years ago when I was born, I'm pretty sure there were happy people around and visitors, like my grandparents, maybe other people who knew my parents, like, oh, we want to come see your son, and whatever, great, fine. Probably should have paid more attention, but I just was, you know, busy breathing. Anyway, it was fairly clean where I was born. Fairly sterile, fairly safe. And who am I that God would be so mindful of me, but allow his son to be born where he did? There were more people who visited and celebrated my birth than there were people who visited and celebrated the Messiah at first. But who am I? This is who I've come to worship every Sunday and every day in between Sundays as well. But he kept the promise. The solution to the damage done in Eden was a Messiah, an anointed one. The first covenant was the letter, the law, and no one could keep it because the garden made us broken, and broken people can't keep the law. Though you try from this moment on, you still have a problem with what you've done until now. And if you started with a blank slate today, you'd mess up by tomorrow afternoon. That's just how the law works. You cannot keep it. So the new covenant was to abolish the law, to defeat the law. But see, God doesn't cheat. God is holy, and he is actually bound to his own qualities of justice, righteousness, and no unfairness or sin, we would say. So the law had to be kept for the new covenant to become its replacement. So the Messiah had to come to do what you and I couldn't, keep the law. The anointed one, this young man whose name is what? Joshua. Don't forget. Jesus is Greek. And what's it Greek for? It's Greek for a Hebrew word, Joshua. I'm just going to tell you, that blew my mind when I first heard that. In seminary, the professor, a Greek professor said, you know his name's not Jesus. I'm like, this dude is a heretic. And he said, well, Jesus is a Greek translation of a Hebrew word, Yeshua, Joshua. Excuse me, what? And so now I impart that to you if you've never been told it before. Jesus' name is Joshua. We call him Jesus because of the Greek in the New Testament. But Jesus comes, and he is the thing that has been promised. He is the anointed one. He is the keeper and defeater of the law. How do I know this? Well, Jesus never said that, actually. I hope, because that's becoming a much more popular thing now for people to be told, oh, Jesus never actually said he was the Messiah. Then you write down John 4:26 for me. Make sure you write down John 4:26. Because every time somebody says this, or when they say it to your children, or they say it to your grandchildren, or you send them off to college with all the hope in the world, and the first history class they get, the first philosophy class they get, they're told all of these things that are untrue about Christianity. And one of them is, even the head of Christianity never claimed to be the head of Christianity. Well, see, in John chapter 4, Jesus has gone into an area that most men would avoid. He's gone into an area called Samaria. And when he gets there, he comes across a well in the center of the town with a woman at it. And this woman is known as a fairly married, hungry woman. She has multiple husbands, and she's not even with the man who's currently she's married to. She's not living the most holy, healthy life. And yet this man comes up to her. Why is she at the well in the middle of the day when it's hottest? Because she can't be around other people. They don't want to be around her. And why is this man going to come up and speak to her? That's not supposed to be. Men aren't supposed to speak to women like this. Plus, she's a Samaritan. And the Samaritans and the Jews, they don't get along. Jews call them dogs. And so he shouldn't be speaking to me because I'm a woman, and he shouldn't be speaking to me because I know he's Jewish and I'm Samaritan and we don't jive. So there's all these reasons why this is a very strange conversation, and she tries to divert that conversation. Jesus says, give me a drink of water. Hey, man, why are you talking to me? And they go on and on. And then she begins to try to spiritualize the moment. And she tells them that they're waiting. We're all waiting. She wants to argue about, where am I supposed to worship? Am I supposed to worship at the temple in Jerusalem on what's known as Mount Zion? Or am I supposed to worship up here on this temple, on this mountain where Jacob was? And Jesus says, it doesn't matter. And so here he says this to her. Sorry, I turned to the chapter 5. Didn't I do that the other week where I was trying to read something out of the wrong chapter? I don't like getting old. Verse 25, the woman says to him, I know the Messiah is coming. I know the Messiah is coming. And when that one comes, he will declare all things to us. So she says, I know that the promise is going to be kept. And I know that when the one keeping the promise comes, he'll explain it all. And in verse 26, Jesus says, I am he. So does Jesus ever claim to be the Messiah? Right there. I am he, the one of whom you speak. She says the Messiah is coming, and he basically says, here I am. So don't you let anybody tell you Jesus never claimed to be what he is. That's just one place that he did. But she says, I know the promise keeper is coming, and Jesus says, he's standing right here. I am he. God kept his promise. He made the promise from the very beginning. He kept his promise through Jesus Christ. And by me receiving that gift, by you receiving the same, we can be a part of the new covenant, the covenant of the Spirit, in which God wishes to dwell within his creation, the only part of his creation that he claimed to be very good, the only part of creation that he made in his own image, the only part of his creation that is just under him in importance. The Bible says even the angels themselves marvel at what you have been given through the Messiah. In other words, by keeping his promise, all of heaven was in awe. So that's why I can have hope. I can have hope that God made a promise. I can have hope that God kept a promise. And I can also have hope that God has a promise yet to be. I hope in the promise yet to be. Now, you understand that with God being outside of time, there is always this idea of things being right now and not yet. Right now, there's a certain aspect of that promise that he's kept, but there's a promise, there's a part of this promise that hasn't been kept yet. Why? Because time hasn't come to an end. Time hasn't ended. All things haven't been brought to their conclusion. And so, yes, right now, I live in the in-between of both the promise being kept and the promise not all the way finished being kept. But that's only from my point of view, because I live inside of this timeline. But you have to understand that the biggest reason today in 2024 that you and I live in the Advent season with hope is because of what's coming combined with what's already come. Now, if knowing that Jesus Christ died to set you free isn't enough, first, you might have a problem. But second, that's not all there is. Have you ever seen the commercials where they're trying to sell you something? This is when you can't sleep, and so you're up late at night. Every channel's turned into an infomercial. Maybe you're trying to buy tape that can hold a boat that was sawed in half together. Or maybe you're trying to buy a slap chop so you can put your vegetables on the table and just take out your frustrations and bang on them, and then poof, they're chopped, okay? Maybe you're buying a set of pots and pans or magic Teflon. We don't use Teflon anymore because it's killing us, but whatever coated skillets, I don't know, but you see all that, and they're like, and you get this for $49. No, it's always like 7 easy payments of $49.95. And then they say every time, but wait, there's more. And see, that's the truth about Jesus Christ. When he walked out of that tomb, that was the, you can have redemption with the creator of the universe, all for nothing other than expressing your faith in the one that he sent. But wait, there's more. And the more is that I am not just redeemed here, I am redeemed eternally. And I live now, but he is coming to take me to where he is. How do I know that? The most famous passage is John chapter 14, verse 3. This is the final conversation Jesus will have with his disciples. He is about to be turned over to the law. He is about to be killed. He is about to be put in a tomb. And yet he tells them, I have to go, but if I go, don't worry, I will come get you and take you where I am. This is what it says, not Mason's translation, but the actual Bible. It says this in John 14:3, And if I go to prepare a place for you, I am coming again. And I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you will be also. So you see, when you're teaching children, and by the way, if you have children or you are anywhere connected to children, this is something you need to be able to explain. And I don't mean this ugly, like, hey, if you can't do anything but study your way through it, then shame on you. I don't mean that. I just mean these are simple things that God taught us to teach. We need to be able to explain to them. Now, when's the last time? I don't expect a child to say, oh, excuse me, what time will our Advent be at Grandma's house? If your kid talks that way, man, y'all's family must be weird. Okay? Like that's, what? I'm weird. Well, okay, I was going to say I'm weird and even my kids didn't talk that way. But Advent, originally what's the word mean? Arrival, to arrive, to come, to show up. And Jesus says, I have two of these. I showed up and I'm going to show up again. I will Advent a second time. How do I know that he will? He said so. If I go, which he did, then I am coming again. I will come again. So that candle is lit because of the hope I have in what he did and what he's gonna do, the promise yet to be. Now, when he says he's coming again, what exactly is that like? Well, again, for those of you who started in that Revelation class, probably on the very first Sunday, you might have heard Revelation 1:7, which says this, behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. So it is to be. Amen. And when it says all the tribes will mourn, that's referring to the people outside of even the new covenant. That's referring to the people who turned their back on the Christ even when his gift was so freely offered to him. They will mourn his second arrival. Why? Because it doesn't mean good news for those who rejected him. But notice the phrase, he is coming on the clouds. Why do they make that distinction? Because how did he show up the first time? In a manger, in a tiny backwater town called Bethlehem. Why did he even come in Bethlehem? Because it had been prophesied that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. What does Bethlehem mean? How does even the name of stuff in the Bible tell me about this from the very beginning? Bethlehem, Bethlehem, the house of bread. And how does the Messiah come to be in the house of bread? Because he says, I am the bread of life. It is all like this. You don't read the Bible verse and then another verse and then another verse and it's all disparate and separated. It's all united, just like being told in Revelation chapter 1 that he is coming on the clouds. Jesus himself in Matthew 24:30, I didn't put that up there. Matthew 24:30, Jesus speaking says, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. And then all the tribes of earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. Jesus himself said, when I come the next time, I'm coming on the clouds. But did Jesus just make that up, or was that always God's design? Well, you go all the way back to the Old Testament in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13, and Daniel is describing a dream, a vision that he's had, and he said, I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like the Son of Man was coming. And he came up on the Ancient of Days, was presented to him. Daniel is seeing the end of time. And at the end of time, he sees the Messiah in this vision, though he doesn't know what he's looking at. He's describing it as best he can. He says, I see one looks like the Son of Man, meaning the Messiah. And they see him coming on the clouds. Then Jesus says to everyone who's listening to him, pay attention to me when I tell you that when I come back the second time, it will be on the clouds. And then in Revelation, it says, and behold, coming on the clouds is the Son of Man. He will come again because he said so. Amen. Yes, amen. And how else is he keeping that promise? Perhaps, I say this all the time, perhaps the most famous, but this is extremely well known, Revelation chapter 21. And behold, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the old heaven and the old earth had passed away. There was no more sea. Isn't that weird? If you like deep sea fishing, too bad for you. Go to heaven? Can't do that. That is not what that means. The sea, in the days of John, is a sign for lostness and death. Because if you sail on a boat, and that boat has an accident, and you disappear, you are never claimed. You are never found. There's no burial. There's no nothing. You have disappeared. And so John says, there isn't a see here. There isn't a disappearing. There isn't a lost anymore. I saw a new heaven. Why is it new? Because God said, behold, I am making all things new. Jesus says, I'm gonna do exactly that. And I assure you that in eternity, it's already done. Is it done for you and me right now? No. Because my knee is hurting right this second. I feel age in my right hand. I'm pretty sure, by the way, you young bucks, I'm beginning to experience arthritis. Well, my experience of that means that that promise hadn't been kept right this minute. But again, I say to you, in eternity, it's already done. In eternity, at this moment, there is already the new heaven and the new earth. There is already the resurrection of the body. There is already the full glorification of every believer. Right now, it's already done. But for me, here, in time, not so. Now, you might be thinking, that doesn't make a lick of sense, sir. So, I spent an hour and a half making you this impressive display. Now, you look at that and say, that took you an hour and a half? And I say, do better, okay? Set a clock and you tell me you can do that in an hour and 15. I don't know why it took me so long, it just did. Now, let me explain what you're looking at, because I want you to have an understanding of something that sometimes people don't understand. Now, what you're looking at in its big title name is a display of something called puncticular eternity. Puncticular eternity. You see, in the Bible, there seem to be two conflicting statements. Paul says, one, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. That means when I die, I'm in heaven. But then to the Thessalonians, he says, I don't want you to be ignorant, brothers, about those who are asleep in the Lord, meaning dead, sleeping, waiting for the bodily resurrection that's promised according to the Word of God. So that's weird. How do I be asleep and waiting on God, but also absent from the body and present with Him? Well, when I think of that on a timeline like I am a part of, it doesn't make sense. But when I think of it like this, which I would submit to you is the true way to understand this, then it makes perfect sense. Now, what are you looking at? All right, on the left, you see a black dot and it says creation. There God spoke all things into existence. Then you follow that line, it's time. Time is moving on that line from left to right. Then you get to the end of it. On the right-hand side, you see a stop sign, and it says, end. That will be the second advent. That will be when no more candles are lit. There is no more advent to await. He has come the second time. He has brought all things new. Behold, no more sea, no more crying, no more sickness, a new heaven and a new earth. Up higher, though, you see what I tried to make purple, but I think it looks bluish, I don't know. There is a point. Now, it's a big point, but it's just a point. We might refer to it as a moment, but it is never ending, this moment, this point of time. Now, I say this to you, by the way, especially for those of you who long for and recognize the absence of your loved ones. Sometimes we struggle, we think, oh, they feel the separation. They're in heaven, but here I am, and there's this separation. I hope this brings you as much comfort as it brought me when it was explained to me. Now, inside of eternity, what's happening in that point of time that's taking place, and I say it to you, right now it's happening, and tomorrow it's happening, and the next day it's happening, because it's not happening in a timeline. It's happening in eternity where there is no time. Inside of that point, there is Revelation 21, new heaven, new earth, no sea, no crying, no tears, no death. There is the bodily resurrection. It's already happened. All the bodies have resurrected out of the ground. God has made them whole and new. There is the glorification of believers. See, I'm being made better every single day through the power of God as I live my life, but I will not be fully and completely glorified as Jesus was until the day I'm in eternity with Him. And then also taking place there is the judgment of all mankind. So if you really like learning that kind of stuff, you know, like Revelation says, He's going to separate the sheep and the goats, and He's going to cast some into the lake of fire and some, all that stuff, it's happening in eternity. And everybody goes there. Please don't make a mistake. Please don't make a mistake and think that because you belong to Jesus Christ that you don't go through judgment. You do. The Bible says all will pass through the fire. Everybody goes through judgment. What's the difference between me and a hell-bent sinner who never confessed the name of Jesus Christ? at the end of that judgment, I get to say, but him, but he said, but Jesus. It's the only difference. All of that is taking place in that point. Well, you see, you got a timeline there, and at creation, at some point, Adam died. After him, sometime later, Joseph died. That's somebody else you might know from the Old Testament. Moses. Pretty big chunk of space between Moses and David. David died. David's not alive today, the king of Israel. And Peter died, missionary to the Jews. Paul died, the missionary to the Gentiles. They all died. Somebody else you might be more closely connected to with your knowledge of history, George Washington, the father of the United States of America. Yeah, well, he's not kicking anymore. He's dead. Also, Abraham Lincoln, probably the most famous and well-liked president in American history, old Abe Lincoln. He died because somebody shot him in the head. Billy Graham, the greatest evangelist of the 20th century. Guess what? He died. Has the coolest casket I've ever laid eyes on. It's a pine box with a cross on the lid made by prisoners in Angola prison in Louisiana. And if I thought I had the kind of swing he does to get them to make me one, I'd have it already. But I'm not Billy Graham, so not going to happen probably. But he's dead. And then you see on there, at some point, I know it's going to blow your mind, but I'm going to die. I will die. And then I put there for you, you're going to die. And then if God tarries and life keeps going on for dozens and dozens and hundreds of years, there's going to be other people that die. But I want you to notice that no matter where I am on that line, when I die, where do I go? That same moment. When I die and go to heaven, Paul will not have spent the past 2,000 years there. Paul and Mason will have arrived in eternity at the same time. Almost like, preacher, how can that be? Because you have to break your brain from thinking about heaven existing in time. Hear what Peter is telling you. In eternity, a day is 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is a day. Now, if you say to yourself, that doesn't make any sense, you're almost there. You know why it doesn't make sense? Because his point isn't trying to give you a metric of counting. Peter is saying, time doesn't work the way it does here, there. There isn't time there. There is never-ending peace. It's foreign. You can't comprehend it. How can we live forever and never have an argument? You know why you struggle to comprehend that? Because you're broken, just like me, and the flesh can't comprehend that life could exist that long and we never fight. Not a soul in heaven is struggling with an addiction or having a problem with laziness or overworking or any of the problems that people have. Nobody's having that problem. Why? Because that promise is yet to be kept, but it's there. And I'm just working my way toward it as he lets me live my life until he says, son, you're finished. And when he says I'm finished, that's not a bad thing. It's not a miserable thing. That will be, I tell you with all certainty, the greatest reward I will ever have been given. For God to say, you're done, come home. And so it doesn't matter how long since a loved one passed away or how much longer since my grandchildren will die into the future. God, I pray deeply and passionately that their faith has long before then been put in Jesus just like mine is. But when I show up in heaven, I turn my head, there's my wife, maybe. And when I turn my head the other way, there's dad and mom and my kids and my... And the Bible says, I will know them as I am known. None of them will be a mystery to me. And everything will be laid bare. All of it happening. Boom. Why? Because Jesus kept his promise. Now, tomorrow might be the most miserable day of your whole life. But I'm telling you something that's true and always will be. No matter how miserable down here might seem to be, you have the one thing that no one ought to be able to take from you because of the one who's given it. Now, if your hope is in me, or your hope is in your spouse, your hope is in the security of your job, I understand. You will be disappointed. I know. But if your hope is in God Almighty, who made a promise from the beginning of creation, and in turn kept that promise through the Messiah in Bethlehem, and is now keeping that promise, that I will see its fulfillment in glory, I have no reason to have no hope. Instead, I have all the reason to hope. And I have all the reason to share that hope. And that is what Advent season is about. both being reassured about what I know to be true and then sharing that in my attitude, in my speech, in caring, as Becky mentioned, that my friends might not be here today, in caring that there are those who have never been here, in caring as something, now this isn't like self-promotion, but in caring as something as foolish as handing people candy canes on the side of the road, in caring how I talk to my students in the classroom or my children at home, in caring how my workmates see me in my job, in caring how my parents see me as a son or a daughter, in caring about the gaze that my children might turn toward me and the judgment that they pass. All of that exists under the umbrella of hope. Why are you the way you are? Somebody ought to ask you at least once in your life. Part of your answer can be, I am this way because of the hope I have in Jesus Christ. Because he is a kept promise that keeps on being kept. And I am free. And you can be too. Christmas is a season of freedom where we celebrate God keeping his word. A word he didn't even have to give. And my prayer is that over this entire season, you will both either be cemented in this truth or accept it for the very first time. That hope is a gift to you specifically. Not to everyone, though it is. You, by name, is a gift to you. Both to have and to give away. That's Christmas. That's hope. And I hope that that's something you have more than you realize. Let's pray together. Almighty Lord in heaven, I come to you grateful that you hear my words, so very thankful that my prayers are listened to. I pray for my family here in this room, for my family abroad, for my community and my country, that this would be an Advent season unlike those that we have celebrated before, not out of a contest for which might be better, not that we might have more funds to spend on more presents, nor that we might have the opportunity through all of the events of this season to not only cherish, but openly confess of the hope that is in us. The hope that comes not because of our just positive thinking, but because of our knowledge, our faith in the promise you kept through Jesus Christ and the open door we have to be members of the new covenant. I thank you that that covenant has been shared with us throughout time, through your holy scripture and through those who have expressed its truth to us, that we might hear it. You say in this holy Bible that faith comes by hearing. So we're grateful, each and every one of us who possess that faith, that we were given the chance to hear. But I ask then if we have heard, we would accept the mantle of responsibility to be the one who speaks, that others might hear. And that others might see, not only with the things we say, but with the lives we choose to live, the power that that hope has in the one who is sold out to it completely and who knows the depth and the truth of it. This whole Christmas, what I pray most of all is that faith will be kindled and rekindled, and that we will be able to celebrate in a way far, far beyond packages and traditions. That we will celebrate in spirit and in truth, that you might be truly worshiped. Open the hearts of those who need it. Speak your words, I ask in your holy name. Amen.